Okay, today I'm talking about sectarianism in Syria, and we know that Syria is thought to be the country where sectarianism is suffered the most. However, we don't know, I mean, in what sense it is suffered, whether it is a social disease, so-called social disease, or a political issue in Syria. Well, I believe, and I will treat sectarianism as a political instrument, a political tool for gaining and maintaining political support. So the analysis of sectarianism in the Syrian context is far more complex than Shia versus Sunni discourse. And while in general in the Middle East this category is picked as a justification for political instability, its relevance is rarely demonstrated. So I will try to fill this gap. And by saying that in the Syrian conflict, that divide and rule strategies became a necessity for maintaining power by the different armed groups fighting in Syria. And their divisiveness has affected the opposition itself, described as more divided than ever, with so-called moderate groups that drag into the vortex of radicalization. So on both sides, not all groups are openly sectarian, with some of them outside sectarian constraints. The result is the radicalization of pro-rebel sentiments on the basis of religion, with an exacerbation of the use of the force by using sectarian terms as a justification. And violence turned out as tawahush or brutality, which in return produces fear and religion antagonism. So we can see this kind of loop going on in the Syrian context. So I think that sectarianism, extremism, and Islamophobia interact as consequential factors. And I think that there is the need to reconsider sectarianism as an instrumental rather than an analytical category. So I will start with sectarianism on Syria. And the politically intended sectarianism can be defined as the formation of different political groups deriving from the membership of a historically and doctrinally defined religious communities, or ta'if, with the meaning of sect. There are nine different militias fighting the Syrian army and their allies, and they are, some of them are openly sectarians, others not. Amongst the former ones, only three are openly sectarian. So Al-Qaeda are based Al-Nusra, ISIS or Daesh, and Jaish al-Sunnah or Sunni army. On the other hand, amongst the regime's internal allies, there are Shia groups like Jaish al-Muwahideen or Army of Unitarians and the Druze community and Jewish tribe militias, as well as Shia. Apart from these groups, it is not possible to find a unique political line for the support, not even the sectarian one. If we look at Christians, not all Christian groups support al-Assad. On the other hand, not all Sunnis fight for the fall of the regime. In particular, moderate and secular political groups like the Arab Nationalist Guard and Ghuragan Hasham, wishing to establish a non-religious government in Syria, sympathize for their regime. Other moderate, more secular groups like Hasb Movement, Non-Restore Brigade, are not openly Islamist, but with the rebels. The former had an alliance with the Free Syrian Army, the latter is formed around Syrian upper class. Instances of anti-Assad Christian political groups are represented by Syria Kuno Party and Suturo, requesting protection for Christians despite al-Assad. The former one is exclusively Syriac, while the latter also has non-Syriac Christian members. Within them, the Syrian Democratic Party supports the regime instead. In the exploitation of sectarian feelings, both Bashar al-Assad and the Islamic State-inspired groups are major opposing beneficiaries. As for Bashar al-Assad, in 2011, after the manifestation of political opposition, he started to use the sectarian term referred to as an instrument of his opponents, mostly media and extremists. After the uprising, Bashar al-Assad has also driven the attention towards the minority rule of his regime, focusing and relying on minoritarian identities. Many argue that he has followed a sectarian agenda for maintaining the support of minorities and counting on the power of his foreign allies, Russia and Iran, above all. Now, it's easy to observe that the support of the Syrian regime comes from Shia-ruled country like Iran and Shia-based party like Hezbollah. In addition, even Russia, in order to justify the involvement, has often referred to the protection of Orthodox communities there. However, even though the international dimension is not really an interest of this paper, it is worth noting that the sectarian label is not even sufficient to describe the lines of the so-called resistant axis. In fact, it is impossible to ascribe the Sunni-Hamas support, I mean the coalition between the Sunni-Hamas party and the Syrian regime in sectarian terms. So if we look at the way in which Bashar al-Assad uses sectarianism, so in one of his 2011 speeches, he states, quote, "They invoke detestable sectarian discourse, which we have never endorsed and which we only see an expression of a hateful ideology which has never been part of our religion, history or traditions, and which has been an anathema and a sacrilege to our national, pan-Arab and moral identity. In all these issues, and with the exception of the first component, I'm talking about a small minority which constitutes only a very small part of the Syrian people." So the pronoun they at the very beginning of this extract refers to protesters representing a minority of Syrian population. This to me is an exemplar case of reversal of minority-majority issue and of sectarianism as belonging to a restricted section of population, losing religious value. Pan-Arab ideology is still important in the politics of identity of the Syrian regime and also now represents a counterpart to sectarianism. The Palestinian thinker Hazmi Bishar comments on the same speech as follows. So, quote, "Syrian President Bashar al-Assad had no pulse in his 30 March 2011 speech about characterizing the protest movement as sectarian sedition that aims to destroy stability and spread chaos. It was clear in his speech that the regime is very interested in spreading fear about sectarian strife, even to the point of provocation, as proof that the authoritarian state is the only form capable of presenting social and political unity in Syria, and that any concessions to democratic aspiration will lead to sedition and division," end quote. So the use of fear of sectarianism card represents an auto-fulfilling prophecy surrounding sectarian divisions. In a more recent speech in 2016, the Syrian president returns on sectarianism again, saying, quote, "The sectarian systems turn the people of a homeland to enemies. Thereby, colonialist countries introduce themselves as protector to certain groups inside the homeland," end quote. Here, the fulfillment of the prophecy is evident in the description of a once united homeland into a now divided country. This time, in 2011, sectarianism was the instrument of the protesters inside Syria. Here, sectarianism is now conceived as external forces, so the colonialist countries having internal disastrous consequences. On their sides, Islamic State's extremist groups have exacerbated and promoted sectarian violence through their anti-sectarian propaganda paradoxically. As Ignatev notices, in an almost Obesian context in Syria, where fighters regard each other with suspicion, Islamist fighters' core is not the defense of a multi-confessional society like the Syrian one, but the creation of an Islamic caliphate in the Arab lands. Kokbu reports that some of Sunni secular civil rights activists were killed or kidnapped or forced to flee by jihadist groups like ISIS. This testifies that anti-sectarian alternative is monocultural, monoreligious, and sectarian once more. I will analyze in brief some of ISIS comments on sectarianism and even their treatment of minorities in Syria in the ISIS and Islamic State held areas in Syria will be explanatory of this sectarian strategy. As Bayman points out, sectarianism is an important element of Sunni Salafi extremist propaganda and its power of attraction all across the world. Quote, Sunni fighters are likewise flocking to Syria, driven in large part by sectarian message that their community is under attack from an apostate regime, end quote. Some of them, some of Sunni Salafi fighters join Islamic State groups. And Bayman also stresses that some groups in Syria have parted sectarian rhetoric for instrumental reasons, becoming even more extreme in their sectarian orientation. The paradox is represented by the fact that groups like Daesh claim to represent a solution to sectarianism and to religion diversity in Syria. In other words, they denounce sectarianism and exploit sectarian feelings at the same time in order to fulfill their political dream of a religiously homogeneous Islamic State in Syria. In a statement to the people and the fighters of ISIS, published by the Journal of ISIS Arabic, the official spokesman of ISIS concludes, quote, "Thereafter know that a tribal sifting and selection are necessary between a period and another. For some people who entered your ranks who are not of you and you are only claimants. And thus some disorder has occurred, expel the filter, purify the ranks." So in this passage, the exclusivist nature of ISIS propaganda and the sacred value of its message of purification, even in the Syrian lands, is evident. The result is likely to be a creation of an illusion of homogeneity within a heterogeneous country and heterogeneous society like Syria. So if we look at the Islamic administration of rebel-held areas, they adopt what is known as the Hayal Sharia, translating into Sharia authority, or known simply as Haya. The model is adopted by various rebel groups and Islamist units who seek to, quote, assert their authority over civilian life, imposing Islamic codes and punishments, and administering day-to-day matters such as divorce, marriage, and vehicle licensing, end quote. Despite an initial welcoming from some civilians who just wish to restore authority after years and years of anarchy and chaos and destruction, the code was not well accepted by minorities and secular opposition activists. Islamic law or Sharia is another point in the quest for Syrian political authority at the moment. It is the foundation for the dream of the caliphate and is thought to be fundamental for concrete representation of Muslim identity in Muslim majority countries like Syria. On the other hand, Islamic law is the main target of attack by Islamophobes. In general, Islamophobic discourses emphasize the major nature of Sharia, stressing the negativity of religious legislation in public sphere and promoting its banning in Western secular societies. There are reports stressing Syrian Christians' fear of Islamist takeover. And as Reynolds notices, unlike Egypt, where Copts were part of the opposition against Mubarak, from the very beginning, Syrian Christians were mostly distant from the Syrian revolution. Facebook operating platforms such as Syrian Christian Watch publishes posts promoting anti-Islam sentiments. Syrian Christian Watch uses anti-Islam narratives in defense of real and imagined persecution threats. In one of the posts, a user quoted, quote, "Islam is not a religion, it's a political ideology, the ideology of a retarded culture. Nobody will silence me, no terrorist threats, no charge, nobody," end quote. The same incipit was used by the right-wing Dutch populist, some populist politicians. In the same Facebook platform, a comment to Trump's ban says, quote, "Muslims are cancerous to freedom," end quote. There are also reports of Daesh and Muslim Brotherhood's destruction of churches and videos of their militias, alongside general anti-Islam statements. "Islam is without refinement or beauty," they quote. Again, "Religion of Muhammad is religion for pigs," sorry, another quote. So the Syrian Christian Watch portal is a concrete example of a typically Islamophobic practice of instrumentalizing the Salafist takeover in Syria for criticizing Islam itself as a religion. Of course, this is only one instance, and it is important to clarify that Islamophobic prejudices are based on generalization of Muslims as all extremist Islamists, as supporters of violent, aggressive, and terrorist political ideologies. Such mistaken assumption can lead to an as much mistaken reversal. All opponents of Islamism are Islamophobes. It is true that Islamophobia can have different nuances, but to me, in no sense, it can be associated to anti-Islamist sentiments alone, which are popular amongst Syrian Christians, apart from that evidence of Syrian Watch portal. Anti-Sharia discourses that might be associated with anti-Islamism are not themselves, but can lead to Islamophobic discourses, as in that instance. And also in the case of right populist wing in Western policies. In Syria, hostility to Sharia is due to the Islamist outcome of other revolutions as well, and due to the fear of an Islamic state in Syria. The reasons for fears of Syrian Christian minorities are extremely complex and have to be investigated in depth. I will try to summarize, given the time limitation. In the Syrian case, Islamist groups like al-Nusra or Daesh represent the emerging dominant group to Syrian Christians. In their eyes, Islamist ideology is not leading, but only dominant and only exercising coercive force alone, as Gramsci would say. It could be said that Daesh is not threatening because of its Islamic culture, rather because of its illegitimate and dominant nature. So only a little amount of that has to do with Islamophobia. This is due to the revival of extremist Islamism in Syria as a realistic threat, the occupation from external fighters wishing to implement a narrow conception of Islamic law has materially and physically impacted on the lives of the inhabitants of those villages. And I've spoken to some Syrian Christians in diaspora, and they told me about the terrible stories of kidnapping by Daesh. So Ed Choudhury notices, quote, "The revival of Islamic law as imagined by then Islamist groups would result not in greater freedom and a better economic distribution, but would bring about a morally better society through cultural reform of those freedoms that have led society astray, freedom for women, religious minorities, as well as secular Muslims." Islamism, as interpreted in Syria, considers the secular-based religious freedom of Syrian minorities as factors for societal degradation or facade in society. So in order to restore morality, the liberty of religious minority needs to be constrained, pushing the interpretation of Sharia to its extremes. Only in part then, fears of Islam are justified by a diffuse ignorance of Islamic law amongst non-Muslim Arabs, which is an issue as well. But the other part consists of its extreme implementation in the areas where Islamists have come to power. The treatment.
Maybe just wrap up.
I was about to finish.
Sorry.
So all in part then, fears of Islam are justified by, the treatment of both Muslim and non-Muslim minorities by ISIS appears consistent only with one of the three families, the so-called non-Muslim families within the Islamic State. And this is the family of the war. And so they are called infidels, kuffar, when there is a war between their state and the Islamic State. So they consider those minorities actually in a war state with them. This also is applied to Muslims, both Sunni and Shia, who represent a threat to Islamic State and or first offense to for pure Islam or apostasy. And this is the strategy of brutality or tawahush, which includes mass killing, kidnapping, apostasy, judgments over civilians. So instead of being considered as protected people, dhimmis, people of the book, there are cases of persecution of Syrian Christians in rebel-held areas. The code is the following, if you want to know. So the Christian will have to pay the jizya, convert, or be killed. So in such atmosphere, both Muslim and non-Muslim Syrians at the moment are forced to make decisions for defending their religious identity, also in their political support. And this does not necessarily mean that Syria is an endemically sectarian society.